many times the challenges we would never ask for are those exact things that equip us for what's in store for us next.
Welcome to the stage, Nicholas Fairley.
How do I serve the tribe? What can I do? What's the next thing I can do?
Most unselfish thing a person could do is expand.
No other option besides hard work.
How they can live this three-dimensional lifestyle.
YouTube, what's going on, guys? Nicholas Fairley here. Today's episode is phenomenal, going through divorce, success, multi-million dollars, maybe some crazy topics around health, things I probably can't say here without getting censored, so you're going to want to stay to the very end. If you're new here, I'm Nicholas Fairley. This is my channel. You can hit that subscribe button if you like the content. You can see all these different videos around creating three-dimensional businessmen, health, wealth, relationships, the three things that men cannot outsource. So why not get really good at? And I bring in multimillionaires, professional athletes, Navy SEALs, etc., through trainings, Q&A, and also interviews just like this to bring you the best content on planet Earth and possibly beyond, even though we don't know if there's other life outside of it. If there is, then it definitely beats out all that stuff as well. So go ahead and hit that subscribe button. Click that little notification bell so that you get new updates when new things go out. Today's episode, again, I have a great friend of mine that we met on a cruise in the middle of nowhere. Well, technically, he said at Topgolf during my birthday. And this guy ended up being a phenomenal guy with an amazing wife that turned out to be a naturopathic doctor and a freaking stud when it came to business building. He's got a phenomenal, huge business and a huge family. And this episode is going to bless your life. Welcome, my friend, Wallace Nelson. Wallace, dude, welcome to the BDB podcast.
Thank you so much, Nicholas. Glad to be here, man.
I was thinking back. I was like, did we really build our relationship in the middle of nowhere, meaning on a cruise? Was that the first time that we really got to hang out and get to know each other?
Do you know what? It actually was even a little weirder than that. We went and we would have met on the cruise, but I think it was right around your birthday and somebody had planned a birthday celebration to go to Topgolf. And somehow it ended up with just me and Ashlyn there with you and Amanda. So we ended up like having a private Topgolf thing without ever having met before. It was awesome.
That is so funny, dude. I was trying to think back. There's a lot of things. And then this is right before we got on a cruise. We hung out the entire time. Dinners, mostly we just went to dinner. We stayed up to like 4 a.m. every single day, at least I did. And then so I would sleep, work out, which was awesome. Got in better shape on that cruise. Like, that was cool. And then we'd go out to these nice dinners and stuff. So it was awesome to get to know you there in a different environment. And then obviously back here with ClickFunnels community and Inner Circle and a bunch of different mutual friends, James Friel and the Poolins and all that. So it's awesome to have you here, man, and talk a little bit more in depth than we get to. Because when we're hanging out, talking about stuff, we go through all these like, you know, random topics, whatever we're all talking about, we're having fun. But I'm excited to kind of extract some things that I think would be valuable for me and also be super valuable for these dudes as well.
Excited to do it, man. Thank you.
Totally, man. And right before we were talking, I was like, man, this guy's a health expert. Like, he has a big company. And you're like, man, I could talk about divorce, kids. I mean, you have this huge house there, and it's literally not because you're trying to have a mansion. It's because just to physically have that many kids in one house and human beings, to house them, you need that type of thing. Give people that don't know who you are a little bit of an overview of your life from single to married to single to kids and all these different things and a synopsis of your business world and how it intertwines, just so that people get to know you a little bit better.
Sure thing, man. It's definitely been a journey. So as far as like the baseline of what I do for business, by schooling, I'm a naturopathic doctor, which means that I learned how to help people with their health on the issues of diet and sleep and stress control and exercise and all those kind of natural lifestyle things that can have huge impacts on your health and well-being, with the focus really trying to tune up whatever might not be going well for you in your health, but really lay the foundation for excellent health moving forward throughout your life without having to resort to drugs and surgery and those sorts of things. So I followed an interesting path to get into that naturopathic medicine, which is I actually followed in the footsteps of my mom. You hear about a lot of guys that become doctors because they're kind of following their dad. The doctor in my family was actually my mom. And so I loved watching what she did. I was so inspired listening to people chat with her about how much the work she had been doing had changed their lives. In some cases, they were even saying saved their lives. And I kind of looked at her almost like she was a superhero because she was doing all this cool stuff for people. And I was like, man, I want to do that too. And so I followed her footsteps. I studied all of that with natural health, starting with nutrition and then into my naturopathic medical degree. And when I got out and started practicing, I pretty quickly found that I wanted more than that one-on-one kind of physician-patient impact. I wanted to be able to impact, you know, thousands and tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of people's lives. So I transitioned and started working with other doctors, helping them to integrate natural therapies into their practices. So doctors that usually just did the drug thing, but, you know, ran up against difficulty with some of those things that don't respond that well to drugs, you know, things that actually, for example, like metabolic disease or peripheral neuropathy or diabetes, even in a lot of cases, that just do better with lifestyle interventions than they do with drugs. But they didn't know how to do the lifestyle interventions. So I taught them and provided products and programs that they could put their patients on to help them get all those benefits of the natural health stuff. So that really is how I got working in natural health, is following that example and just letting my passion take me to where it took me and wanting to help as many people as humanly possible. Now on the personal side, I got married really, really young. Got married at 20 years old. My first wife was 18, and we lived a pretty long life together. We were married for almost 20 years, and she and I had 5 kids together. And, you know, things as is wont to happen through life, we kind of grew apart getting married so young and ended up becoming divorced. So I was a single dad of 5 kids.
What do you think, just real quick, for like in that journey, what do you think is the biggest thing, the differences that all of a sudden happen? Like where was the split? Cause sometimes like people just don't spend time together, and because of that kind of just float apart after a while. But what were like the key differences, do you feel like, during that time that really changed from when you were 20, she was 18, and then what kind of was different? What changed?
Yeah. You know, I think at a fundamental level, I believe having a real strong uniting set of goals and values is one of the most important things that can happen in the foundation of a relationship. And one of the symptoms of getting married so young is that neither of us really knew who we were at that age. And sometimes couples get married young like that and they grow together and they, you know, they have the greatest relationship. They have one of the greatest love stories that there ever is growing together. And in our case, that didn't really happen. We began to grow apart a little bit, really on the basis of what we wanted to do, what we wanted to accomplish, what we valued. And I didn't catch that early enough to fix those things. So where I found myself was a long ways down the line, and really kind of feeling like strangers. You know, we fell into that thing you hear about where we were parents and we were roommates and kind of, you know, financial partners in our lives, but there wasn't a whole lot connecting us. And by the time that I think we both realized that was the case, we started doing the work to try to salvage that, much of the work we probably should have been doing all the way along, but just weren't able to bring that back together. It was a situation where when we became divorced, I think that was actually freeing for both she and I, because we were in a position to be ourselves a little bit more, but it's crushing for kids, you know? And that's one of the hardest things I think that's ever happened to me is I was in a position that in many ways I was happier for myself, being able to move forward in a direction that was more in harmony with who I was. But man, there is nothing in my life that equals the pain that came from my kids in that divorce. And, I think I'm probably going to be working to make up for that, like the rest of my life, for my kids. And luckily I still have the opportunity to do that, but, it is what it is. And that's where we ended up.
Yeah. And I appreciate sharing that. My parents broke up when I was 4. So it was maybe a little bit different than if I was older. Mm-hmm. And same thing with my brother. He was pretty young too. And when his dad and my mom broke up, you know, and then I have my sister as well, who had a different mom, same dad. So my brother's got a different dad, same mom. My sister's got the same dad, different mom. And so each of us had our own weird families, which was hard because you think about like my brother would go spend time with his brothers and his family over there. And I'm like, oh, cool. Let's go hang out. My mom's like, no, like you got to come with me and hang out with me. And then I go hang out with my dad, but then my sister's there. And then I leave to go see my mom and she's got a different mom and a different, it was super interesting, yet maybe was not as hard as someone who goes through a divorce as a kid. I can only talk from like this perspective. And sometimes when I talk to people that have had kids longer than me, I'm like, hey, I can't help you, but I can tell you like what it was like being a kid 10 years ago, just the other day, because I'm not that far away from it, like the situations. So I think that's interesting. With the divorce stuff, I feel that most people, and you're pretty even keeled from what I've noticed, maybe like behind closed doors, you punch holes in the wall. I'm just kidding. but you're even keel. Like you're very like methodical. You don't seem like you'll take risks that have big repercussions for the most part that aren't really worth taking. Most people look at divorce as something that's always like hatred. You know, like it's so weird that I think it's weird sometimes. When my parents broke up, their biggest thing was like, I'll never talk to you again after Nicholas turns 18. As soon as Nicholas turns 18, we're never talking again. And it's interesting that I'm like, just a few years ago, you like, and then now you think this, how was that process? Was it, I feel like maybe they think they need to be that way to go separate ways. Was that, what was the case for you guys? Was it angry? Was it upset? And again, these are all things that I think probably happen in general because you feel rejected or all these things. But how was that? Was it a calm divorce? Was it not that calm?
You know, it's a little bit like being out on a sailboat and moving through a variety of seas. There were moments that were pretty tranquil and there were moments that were really, really rough. And I think in our position, you know, I certainly was calmer and felt a little more freed in that process. My ex-wife, was a little more turbulent than I early on. And we definitely went through those days where, you know, from my perspective, I felt like she was trying to hurt me. You know, I felt like there was a lot of resentment and bad feelings and you know, an axe to grind there. Luckily, I made a decision really early on that I wasn't going to do anything in retaliation that would keep that anger in the relationship. You know, I felt that while my kids had been dealt a really tough hand of cards at that point, that they were going to have to find a way through, I thought the best thing that I can do for them here is to try to give them, you know, a kind, stable, happy co-parenting relationship as much as is in my power, because it was important for me that they didn't feel pulled between the two of us. It was important to me that they knew that no matter whether we were together, their two parents loved them and would show up for them first. And it's been a bit of a journey to get there, but I can, you know, gladly report that things get better and better and better as time goes on. And most of that hurt, most of that anger is kind of out of the situation now, so that we can really just focus on trying to be the best co-parents for our shared children as we can.
But the reason I touched on that is because when you look at successful people, successful businesses, successful health journeys, a lot of times we don't ever see the perspective that maybe someone else is going through. I know someone right now that I'll keep confidential that went through like a really bad thing with a pregnancy. And one of the biggest things that I got from it is either one, the information's out there if you want to search for, but generally when you're searching marriage, you're not wanting to look at all the things that could go wrong and then look at all the negative stuff. And so a lot of times you're not prepared for anything. And then when it comes to the other side is that other people that have gone through things, they don't really share it. They don't really share like what really happened. And so no one really ever goes into it knowing what the heck's going on. Maybe this could go all the way back to you probably having to have the sex talk with your kids. It's like, oh, no one really ever did this that well for me. And I don't even know if I could do this really well, because just you're like, oh, there's these bad things and then there's these good things. And you just don't really talk about any of them. And often I found that successful people, like no one said it with kids, how it'd be harder to work, because for me, I want to spend time with my family more than I want to work more. Every time I get on a call with someone, I think, well, that's an hour I couldn't spend time with my son today. So I'm being more intentional with that. But no one ever told me that. And that's all I wanted to touch on some of these things is you run a successful business, have a great relationship, now have a bigger family. And on top of that are a expert when it comes to health and nutrition and like you said, all these natural ways to actually optimize the body. Yet it wasn't done just because you had a great, easy cruise through life. Because I feel like there's some people out there maybe that are going through things. They're like, well, it would be nice to be like Wallace to just, you know, have all this stuff built and like not be going through this divorce or not be going through this co-parenting or not having these kids and or going through this health crisis. And we all have these things that we battle. And so I think it's really cool to touch on some of those things for people to see the reality because you made it through it. You're still alive.
Yeah.
Still kicking, still healthy. So is there anything you want to say about that for the guys maybe out there that, you know, even for me, I'm like, man, like I'm sick right now, right? I'm like, gosh, I don't look at other people post on social media when they're sick. So I'm looking at everyone who's healthy. I'm like, man, when the gyms are closed, I'm like, I'm getting out of shape. Like, but no one else posts when they're out of shape. There's just a million people posting when they're in shape. No one's ever like, oh, I've gotten a little bit more out of shape. So anything you want to say to those people out there that are maybe struggling with that stuff?
Yeah. So I'm a bit older than you. I'm a little further down the road than you are in life. And one of the important lessons that I learned, I think I used to stand on the sidelines, like what you're talking about and going, man, I got all these hard things I'm going through. And it looks like all these people are doing so well. And even though I don't try to compare myself to others, it's kind of natural to see somebody that looks like they're doing a little better than you at some area or another in life and feel deficient, feel like you're behind. With my years, what I've found out is we're all struggling, man. And the people that oftentimes I would have looked at and thought, hey, they aren't dealing with all these hard things. Like life is smooth for them. It's easy. It just seems like they're happy and everything's going well. What I have found out is if I don't understand the struggles in people's lives, it's probably just because I don't know them well enough. To a person, everybody that I really, really know well has been through some dark stuff, has been through some really, really difficult times, and there's always something going on that they're having to deal with as well. So I think that comparing your worst day, you know, you feel all the realities of your worst days, comparing that worst day to the best day of somebody else that they're putting on social media or that they're talking about at a party, of course those things aren't going to match up. And like you said, I love what you were talking about, how people don't talk so much about their struggles, and life would probably be easier if more of us were open to sharing our struggles. And we sat down and when you asked somebody like, hey, how's it going? Instead of going, hey, it's great. Everything's great, which is what most of us do. People would be a little more real with one another and go, man, like this is tough. That's tough. I'm working through these things, you know, because there's always a silver lining to those clouds. As hard as things are, as many crummy things as you might have to deal with at a given moment, there's runway beyond that that gives you a chance to kind of write a new ending to whatever that story is and find happiness and find success. And I know in my case, while I never planned to get a divorce, you know, I planned to have that nuclear family that I married into and began with my kids for the rest of my life, and the plans didn't go that way, and it's like everything that had been lined up just got shattered in that moment, and I had a choice there that it was like, okay, I can either, you know, live in this broken place with everything that's gone wrong and just kind of let my life be a broken life now. I can take a lot of the shortcomings that I had that allowed this situation to fail and go fail again in some new situation, or I can take this as day one of a new life and be really, really self-critical, you know, look and go, okay, where was I at fault? What things did I do wrong? What things could I have done right that I just chose not to do or that I did halfway? And how can I create a better story for whatever comes next for me? And I've been blessed that from that moment of kind of looking myself in the mirror and deciding that I wasn't okay with either of those first two choices. Whatever came next for me, I wanted to write the story that I would be proud of. You know, when things came to the end, I wanted to write the story that would show my kids how to respond to the, you know, all this adversity and difficult things that happen and build something better. I've been very blessed that combined with that approach, the opportunities have been there for me to move forward with that. I was able to marry again, the most incredible amazing woman. You guys know Ashlyn, and she's an absolute rock star, like best thing in my entire life. And the three kids that that she had as a single mom joined my life. And so, you know, we find ourselves now as a really, really close couple, raising eight kids together, which is a ton. I know that's you started this off, I think, talking about how we had to have all this space for all these kids. Yeah, we drive the big van. We have tons of bedrooms because we've got a really big, loving, awesome family. And on top of that, it's not only the personal stuff, but my business did fine before. And while divorce is normally a completely crippling situation to a business, to a financial future, the power of what I was able to create and change in me and the, you know, increase in that power of marrying Ashlyn and having all of those, you know, goals that were completely on the same page with each other. Just a few years out, I am at a vastly better place everywhere in my life than I ever was in my former life. And, you know, that's one of the things.
There's a ton you're saying in there. Keep going.
Sorry. I just wanted to point, I don't mean to talk to you, but, I know that one of the things you've said that impacted me the most was talking about how that marriage relationship is the most important mastermind. And I can't endorse that statement of yours strongly enough. No matter what else is going on, the core relationship and the most powerful, empowering relationship for me is that with my wife, with Ashlyn.
100%. And even you talking about before, it was unaligned goals. Now it's aligned goals and the power of that multiplication process. Because also the most crippling relationship could be an unsupportive spouse by far. The closest person to you, knowing you, accepting you, and encouraging you is super empowering. The closest person to you, knowing you and not encouraging you and crippling you, is the most hurtful as well. So it's like could be polarizing two different sides. And some people maybe have seen the other side. So you talked about that. You talked about things like taking responsibility, whether it's divorce or maybe someone has something that's a different trauma. There's other traumas. This is just one of these super hard things to go through. There's people that let it cripple them for the rest of their life, how they do life. They shrink back, they hermit back, they seclude themselves, maybe for years until they make a decision. Myron Golden always says that all decisions and transformations are always in just one moment. It's like you're one way and then you change. It just sometimes took a long time to get to that point of change or a short amount of time. And so you taking that responsibility, I think, is really big for anyone who's going through this trauma or something bad, maybe a business fail, or maybe you just made a mistake. You know, I remember one time I was driving a truck and I forgot to put it in park. I jumped out. It was so heavy that it didn't really roll right away. And it took off down the street, cars honking. I was like traumatized. I thought I was such an idiot. I started beating myself up. I lost a little bit of confidence even that day because I just was so upset that I could be so stupid. It just triggered something in me. I was beating myself up and it's like, okay, am I going to allow that to just continue to beat myself up? And that's a small thing. And so taking responsibility, like you said, and figuring out what can I do to be better, my best self, leaving here, that was really cool. And the last thing that you said that I believe is really powerful and I want to ask you a question about, you said sharing these different things that we go through, but oftentimes I'm like, man, I'm sick, but I don't even want to tell my clients or anyone like, hey, I'm kind of not feeling good. Cause I'm like, is that just an excuse? Like I still could do stuff. You know, it's like, I don't want to talk about and have people look at me this certain way just cause I'm like, is it really that bad? So my question is, I remember there was this guy, Bubba Stewart, the best black motocross racer that's ever lived, best motocross racer that's ever lived, fastest on the planet. No one would ever argue that. I looked up to him. But this guy jumped things and did things that no one else ever did. They're like, I'm not taking the risk. Since he retired, he now says he hated racing and he always was scared even to do like these jumps that they have to do every single time. And it was interesting because I believe it's even more important for people that are doing really well when they share things even more powerful, because we already look at them like, well, you got this big house and awesome family and hot wife and fit body, and you have these things on the other side that I want, and I don't think that you struggle with the same things that I struggle with in order to get there. When he said that, I was like, I know you're the best motocross racer in the world. And I was scared. I thought, oh man, he's fearless. I'm not. So I just don't have what it takes. And so what's the balance between Yeah, I think it is complainers. If they aren't prospering and they're just complaining about the hard things they're going through, they still haven't even gone through it. Talk to your mentors, your close people, your friends, people that can actually help you out, not general people that aren't going to give a crap. But what's the balance between sharing and being vulnerable and not hiding things and complaining? Because I feel that even though I preach this in some ways, there it's harder for me in other ways, like even being sick right now. I'm like, I'm not going to ever say anything. Like, I don't want people to know that. I don't know what it is, still blockage. So what's the difference? Complaining and sharing and being vulnerable.
You know, I think the big difference is just what you do with that. You know, for me, somebody that's complaining is someone that's using all the hard stuff in their life to take themselves off the hook, you know, to remove the expectation of being able to overcome, to being able to succeed, to being able to still be of value to everyone in their lives. To me, that's a complaint. It's kind of like the negativity without any counterbalance of positivity or drive or something to come from it. But on the flip side of that, just like you were talking about with Bubba, many of the people that I most revere, who have been most inspiring to me, are those that have overcome challenges that, you know, make me go pale thinking having to go through that. But they didn't use it as an excuse, but they didn't hide it either, right? They walked through the challenge of that on a way to making themselves a more well-rounded person, to learning the lessons that that difficulty had to teach them, and then coming out of that stronger and more capable, really because of those difficulties. Many times the challenges we would never ask for are those exact things that equip us for what's in store for us next. And without, you know, the resilience that is created in those challenges, without the mental toughness, without, you know, the drive and the passion that might be created by those setbacks, we may not ever be in a position to really kick butt on that next opportunity that comes.
It's awesome, man. Shifting complete different gears. You talked about natural health. People, I've been seeing these debates on social. Doctors and stuff have like either gotten a lot of praise or a lot of hate. I feel bad for them. They went to school for a long time. They have good intentions, generally, I would say. You know, no one goes into professions like that without wanting to help people in the first place. I don't think anyone's like, well, if I go to school for this long, I can then get into a position where corrupt people can pay me a lot of money to say certain things. Like, I don't think any of them really started that way. And I don't really know anyone who actually is personally that's taken lots of money. Actually, I know a group of doctors one time that were a part of an insurance scam. But other than that, Amanda was watching a video last night that was talking about all these different problems that people have had since this one was about vaccinations, which just said the word that will get me flagged on everything.
Right.
And less about vaccinations in general, but you even talked about that you were teaching these doctors how to help people naturally. Doctors only take a little bit of time to learn nutrition, right? Like a very short amount of time. And again, I'm not saying that doctors are supposed to specialize in things unless they're a general care practitioner. They still don't specialize in these things, but I'm sure there's someone who's a spinal surgeon that knows more about the intricacies of the spine than you do, right?
Correct. Yeah.
And that's like his thing, but he doesn't know maybe anything about nutrition at all, maybe. Like, it's just not his realm. And we need these, like, all of us to kind of work together. What are your thoughts right now on doctors? You can touch on vaccinations if you want, if you care about it. The different problems that people have nowadays that maybe weren't diagnosed then, or maybe they weren't a problem. There's just so much uncertainty for people right now. Do I get vaccinated? Do I not? Do I eat these foods? Do I do this diet? Do I exercise? Do I go back and live like a caveman? Because I look back and I go, well, you only live till you're like 40. So like, what are you going to do? The average lifespan in Africa is like 45. So like, what am I supposed to do? Live off the land? Like, there's all these different things that are contradicting, right? People are like, be like a caveman. I'm like, maybe we have an issue because I'm living to freaking 150 years old. Let's break open this topic a little bit. What are you seeing happening?
There's a ton of conflicting information. You know, I think that's at the root of a lot of what you're talking about, is that, there's so many different things happening at once, and they're coming from people with expertise in different areas. And I really think that the big root problem of that is, you know, the saying, like, when all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. Most folks feel like when they're in the health field, they specialize in this one thing, and it almost serves as a set of blinders for them where they don't see or consider any of the alternate things that might be going on that might be beneficial and of use. So to use your example of like a spinal surgeon or an orthopedic surgeon, if you hurt your back and you go see an orthopedic surgeon, almost no matter what's going on with your back, their solution is going to be surgery, because that's what they do, right? That's the hammer they hold, and doing surgery on your back is going to be like pounding that nail, where there may be many, many other options that are less invasive, that have less downside, that could be useful. And so it's a lot of people with very specific perspectives, feeling like their perspective is the only one that's valuable. And I think what needs to happen with health and wellness and medicine in the big picture is we need to become much more inclusive of the actually large amount of tools that can be available in a given situation, and trying to employ the proper tool in the proper situation so that, we can really take advantage of everything, of every advancement that we have. The other thing I'd like to say with that is, I think one of the issues with medicine is most Americans have outsourced their health and well-being to a doctor in a white lab coat, right? They don't think that much about what they have control over and what they can be doing to keep themselves well, keep themselves from a lot of disease. So they kind of almost wait until they get sick with whatever's happening and then walk in and put everything out of their hands and say, take care of this for me.
You even just said something about that. If the surgeon, his hammer is like his thing that he does is surgery.
Right.
And so it's really not even his fault for him to say, well, you have this problem. The best route that I could see is this, because that's what I do.
Right.
It's almost like the consumer's fault for not being able to look at different options and say, cool, let me go talk to these specialists that are the different ways to get there and figure out what I want to do because it's my body. And, it goes back to even the health thing I talk about. No one's going to eat for you. No one's going to drink for you. No one's going to sleep for you. You get plans. But at the end of the day, it's something that no one else can take care of for you. No one will care about for you. So you should probably get good at this. And we get taught, oh, this person's special. Well, yeah, with your fence in your backyard, it doesn't make any difference. Like, you can outsource the fence getting built in your backyard and someone who wants to build it. And if it's wrong, who cares? But no one's going to eat the food and take the supplements and do all that stuff for you. So maybe this is actually something that people should get more educated in, but there is a lot of blocking of education. And I feel like it's working in a bad way where, I talked about, oh great, I said vaccination, so now I'm freaking screwed on every platform. That there's gonna be a big pop up and all this stuff. And people will talk about censorship, right? They censor certain voices and amplify other ones. And I feel that it's making people more skeptical of even what they're listening to, that even if something's real, they don't believe it's real because how do they know? The other voices aren't being heard. The other hammers and different ways that we can do things aren't being, you probably saw this with even natural medicine. You guys have been silenced for a long time.
Yeah.
Like you have not been the way. I haven't seen anyone do a promotion of, hey guys, let's show people our food on our social media platforms, because we could inspire other people out there that maybe are following you to eat healthy. No, like I've seen, hey guys, make sure you show you got the vaccination, because other people will see it. And if they're scared, they won't be as scared because you, who they look up to, did this thing. And I'm like, well, what about all the other crap that you've skipped over in the process? And again, I'm not even an expert in vaccine. I have no clue. I don't even know what's in a vaccination. I just know the general crap that people say. But this is what I'm seeing. And I'm like, isn't this like the foundation that like freaking 60% of people are freaking obese or like on the edge of obesity or whatever it is, overweight? You know all the stats. This is a very interesting thing. You guys have been silenced too, right? Same thing?
Yeah. Yeah, we have. And to detriment, that's like you said, the field of acceptable information has been narrowed really in an unprecedented way.
Do you think it's a profit, or do you think it's just because that's the hammer? They only know medicine. Because people say, well, you can't make money off telling people to eat healthier.
Yeah, no, I don't know if I put everything with that base of motivation. I don't know that it's strictly just a financial thing. Certainly, there are people that stand to benefit. I think one of the things that that happens is, since everybody's got an opinion, they put something out like, what should we do about this? And some people are saying, you need to do these heavy drug interventions. And some people are saying, hey, just don't worry about it. And some people are going, watch what you're eating. And some people are saying, use an essential oil, or just meditate, or just pray. And in reality, there's probably benefits from many of those things, but it gets to be a very, very confusing situation. And with that hammer and nail analogy, if you're a straight medical guy, that's all you want to talk about is, and you want to completely, get rid of everything else. If you're a straight, like, essential oils person, you're like, this is all you need. And the truth is that any one thing probably is not the answer with that. So I really like to think about things. I know you're a very convicted religious guy. It's one of the things I admire so much about you. And I kind of have always had this thought that when people need help from God, you pray to God and ask for help, and God will help you. But I think there's also an expectation where God's like, listen, you're capable too. So you start doing the work you can, like, you work in the direction you want to be, and I'll help. Where, some folks go, once I pray, there's nothing required of me. I don't even need to worry about moving in a direction. And I feel like God wants us to help ourselves where we can, and He will make up the difference, right? There's that balance that comes in there. And I think that's actually kind of a principle of life, that people are treating their medical care in much that same way, that they're going, well, once I get sick, I'll just outsource this to some guy in a white coat, and he'll make everything better, or she'll make everything better.
That isn't healthy. We went to a doctor's office the other day, remember, honey? And I'm like literally tell you, don't smoke cigarettes, or it's going to be really, really bad for whatever this specialist was. And the first nurse that comes in to help us out, I go, like, I grew up, both my parents smoke all the time. I'm like, this chick smokes so many cigarettes, not even funny. I'm like, oh my gosh, this person who's smoking cigarettes is like, this is what you're not going to want to do. And again, maybe we could quote that with, I'm sure that you've had a piece of, maybe not you, but some health people have, like, fast food every once in a while. I'm like really hell bent. I've never had Chick-fil-A. It's like a religious, amazing, right? It's like a Christian fast food place, man. That, like, everyone hates that I talk about this. And then they call me out because I had raw fish the other day, and like, but I saw Seaspiracy, and like, you're doing the same thing as me when I eat Chick-fil-A and whatever. I'm like, all right, whatever. But ultimately, like, I'm like, I'm pissed that Chick-fil-A, they use the worst ingredients ever. Yeah. I'm like, if you're going to represent Christianity, I want to see some freaking quality. Like, you're just the same as everyone else with, like, a little Christian wrapper on it, and you're doing nothing different. Yeah. Have you seen the ingredients list on these dudes?
Yeah, there's a ton of brutal stuff.
And I'm not saying, like, don't
stuff
have
you would never use in your own kitchen, you know?
Dude, it's insane. So let's jump into some things that people can do, just to wrap it up, some, like, rapid fire stuff.
Sure.
What I like about what you're doing is, I even said, hey, sometimes we got to be matter of fact, because that's what people want to hear. Like, you need to do the keto diet, or you need to do carnivore because of this. And I like that too, because I'm like, okay, sounds good. But some options would be cool. What are some things that people could do leaving here to boost the immune system, maybe boost testosterone, feel leaner, feel healthier, and maybe even some options? Hey, maybe look at trying this, this, or this. These are things that may be a good fit for you, or one of the others, totally fine as well. I've never done carnivore. I've been interested, haven't been convinced. I've never done keto. I've eaten, like, kind of more of a balanced paleo style. I would say, if I were to put something on it, what are you seeing working right now that we could take away? How much water should we drink? Should we be breathing better, managing stress? Tell me some of the hacks.
Sure. I think that the most foundational piece that most people miss is that, the quality of your food matters more than almost anything else you're doing with that food. So if we can break it down and look at why we eat in the first place, it's to provide our bodies with nutrition, right? Like, sure, it's fun to eat, food tastes good, but the whole reason our bodies need to eat is for nutrition, vitamins, minerals, fiber, proteins, fats, all of those things that have to happen to, you know, make this incredible machine work. And I think that the biggest game changer for most folks is, no matter what else you're doing, if you allow the quality of your food, meaning eating, you know, good quality whole proteins and fruits and vegetables and good healthy fats, if that is your primary focus, it almost doesn't matter that much what else you're doing along with that. So people generally use these kind of, you know, what I would call like gimmick or brand name diets, whether I think you mentioned like paleo or keto or things like that. They normally
don't eat red meat ever. They only eat chicken and they only eat red meat or all these different balances. I like what you said though. Like, first off, quality, because people would say, is it really worth it? I know probably people think about it with kids. Kingston's been eating like some of his meals are freaking couple bucks every single meal each day.
Yeah.
And because we're trying to make him really high quality things, I've even had thoughts go through my head, go, does it really make a difference? Am I really just investing like a bunch of money and it's not really that much better? Or is it contaminated as well? So I think some people maybe are going through that, yet thinking of it from the foundation, like that's why we eat food. If that's screwed, then the rest of it's screwed.
It's, you know, it's like, true. Yep. That's and cool. I don't really hang as hard on like organics only as some people do. For me, the big dividing line is, if you can afford all organic, if that's available to you on your budget and where you live, awesome. That's definitely the best thing to do, right? But for many of us, either our access or our finances don't allow that. So I kind of say, any fruit or vegetable that you're going to eat the whole thing, that you're eating the skin and everything, that's where to spend your organic dollars. Stuff you're going to peel, you do pretty well even with traditional produce on that. So that's where you can let some of that slide. Same thing on meats. While we love like free range, grass fed, that's the ideal. If you can't get those, it's still better to eat those proteins than to avoid them entirely. So it's there's this good, better, best, right? And whatever your situation allows you to chase, whatever your best is, do that. But by no means don't do anything because you can't do the best. Like that perfection is honestly the biggest enemy of good that exists, because you're throwing away things that would work really well for you and much better than what you're currently eating, because you feel like you only have to eat the best or eat nothing. And so you end up eating, you know, cheeseburgers from McDonald's or something. And there's a whole lot of middle ground between that perfect grass-fed steak and a cheeseburger, and just moving higher on that scale will pay huge benefits, even if you can't get all the way to the top.
And for the guys that are listening though, I can be hard on them. If you got that extra car you ain't driving, like, sell that freaking car and invest in some of these things. Because my wife, he was even talking about going to this little spa thing for, you know, infrared sauna. Is there any fun hacks that you have outside of the food and stuff like that you feel like are really beneficial for us? Because I think of it sometimes and I'm like, well, sometimes I'm like, I don't know. Does that really work that well? Am I committed to doing this over and over again? Do you like infrared saunas? I had a friend that's been doing ice bath to sauna, to ice bath, to sauna 2 times a day, every single day. And he's like, this is the thing. And he mixes a concoction. Shout out to Ryan Hughes. It's actually really cool. I'm pumped about it. I'm like, he's taking new people through it. And they're like, I feel so good. No inflammation. Are there certain things that are kind of more topical, infrared, cryo, things that you really enjoy that you think would be beneficial for people?
Maybe this will surprise you a little bit. I think a lot of that stuff is really cool. I do a lot of that stuff. We cold plunge here. I've got a sauna, like we've got everything at the house. But, one thing that I think happens is everyone tries to chase these like magic bullets of, I'm just going to do this thing and it's going to make all the difference, while kind of ignoring all of the base stuff that is actually mostly important. I used to do triathlon, and you'd see a lot of guys that would go spend like ridiculous amounts of money on the peak bike that had all the weight stripped off it, right? It was grams lighter, and they spent thousands of dollars for that. But they're out there riding, carrying an extra 20 pounds of body weight. And it's like, man, you totally are missing, like, it's that idea of stepping over dollars to pick up dimes, right? A lot of folks ignore the basics that would make the biggest difference chasing a magic bullet. So I love sauna. I love cold plunge. Like cryo's cool. All those do great things, but they're like the final sharpening at the top of the pyramid. So your efforts ought to go first to those biggest movers. Make sure you're eating good food. Make sure you're following a diet program. Get your sleep in. Drink water so you're hydrated. Try to control your stress. You know, get a daily routine in place that allows you to keep your sanity while still being productive, so you don't have to grind 20 hours a day and wear your body down. Do those basics. When those basics are done, have a ton of fun with all the magic bullet stuff, but that can't come first.
So you do like people following a plan though, not just going out and buying stuff and doing their, when I wanted to lose about 60 pounds of weight, I saw some guy that was fit eat fruit. So I just literally bought it and starved myself, ate some fruit, literally ate no protein for like the first 8 months. I don't even think I had protein besides maybe in a mini corn dog. I would have one instead of seven mini corn dogs. So I was like, I'm eating less. I lost the weight, but I wasn't healthy or strong or any of these things. What's some recommendations for people to, if they want to jump on something right now, a diet plan or some type of lifestyle plan that they could jump on and kickstart these results?
You know, a great place to start is if you'll do what I talked about and manage your food quality, right? And when I talk about that, I'm saying mostly like whole foods, like eat real meat, eat real whole vegetables, eat real fruits.
I just realized that Whole Foods brand is like amazing right now because you just said that. They're like, everyone's going to think of Whole Foods when you say Whole Foods. Not that it's always the best place to shop, but holy crap.
Yeah. It's expensive. They often have good stuff, but it's expensive.
I interrupt you. Keep going.
No, you're good, man. As long as you're focusing on those Whole Foods, it really can be as simple as when you're hungry, eat, and when you're full, stop. Just make sure that they're high quality foods. Now, that doesn't work if you're going to eat Doritos and piles of pasta and white bread. And, you know, if you're eating food that doesn't pack nutrition, your body doesn't know when to tell you to cut it out because it still hasn't gotten the nutrition it needs. But if you're eating actual foods, the way they grow on an animal or the way they grow on a plant, just natural whole foods, dude, it is literally as simple as eat if you're hungry, stop when you're full. Your body is made, designed to handle stuff that way. And it can be that easy as a beginning point. You might get to some point later on where you're like, okay, now I have a goal. I want to chisel my abs out. And maybe at that point, you can do one of those things people do like counting macros or whatever. But in beginning stages, it plain isn't necessary if you'll just pay attention to eating really good quality foods.
So do you feel that most obesity or overweight is from a lack of movement? Is it gluttony? Is it like lack of self-control? Or is it that they're not getting nutrition? So because of that, they're just like consistently eating all this crap. Well, what's the thing? Because you even said, man, if you just, your body naturally will tell you when you're hungry or when you're full, if you just eat the right things, because if you're lacking the nutrition, you'll try to keep searching for it and eating. Why are people overweight?
Wow. Huge, huge, huge topic. You know, and it's one that gets really, really complicated, but it is one in many cases that can be addressed by chasing these highly nutritious, good quality foods. And if you want to think about that, imagine if, you know, that person that maybe was binging on whatever they're binging on, if they switch that out and were like, hey, I don't know how to stop the binging right now, but all I'm eating on this binge is going to be freshly cooked sirloin steak and broccoli. I've been doing this long enough. I can tell you it is freaking impossible to maintain a really unhealthy body mass if you're eating those high quality foods. Your body can't do it. You'll get too full, and it also trips that trigger. Your body's looking for nutrition. So when you're eating tons of food without the nutrition in it, you'll eat it all, and then your body's like, wait, I'm full, but I'm still hungry because I don't have the nutrition that I need to do what I need to do. You put a bunch of stuff in here, but that stuff you put in here wasn't the food I needed. So focusing on that highly nutritious food basically begins to work with your body rather than fighting against all those natural systems in your body. And it is built to be healthy. And all of those things that accompany, you know, these unhealthy body weights where you start to get metabolically deranged and your insulin sensitivity goes crazy. Those things make it so much harder to lose weight. And it requires a little more drastic change in the quality of food that you're eating. But I can ensure you that if that change is made, if that's the one thing you focus on, your body figures that out and the metabolic derangement goes away. And the insulin sensitivity returns to where it's supposed to be. You just can't keep abusing your body and expect it to show up for you the way that you want it to.
That's cool. So even if you're a binger or someone who likes to eat a lot, like try eating a lot of the good stuff first, and naturally you'll probably end up not eating as much. I even did things like when I would go out to pizza, which is actually like our thing that we're doing tonight, which is kind of funny, it's our date night and we haven't eaten a good pizza here. I would eat like a healthy meal before I'd go normally, just because I would not eat as much generally when I'd get there. And I was able to enjoy it. I wasn't as ravenously hungry and like ordering every single thing and then feeling terrible afterwards. And so even what you're saying, it's like, well, pack in your nutrient dense stuff first, and then you may just not really care. And it's wild how you feel when you don't eat the bad stuff sometimes. I've had times where it's when you had the bad stuff in front of you or it's on the menu, you're like, if I just order that, it's going to be so freaking good. Like you feel like you can't live life without it. You leave the restaurant and you feel so good about yourself afterwards because you're like, man, I don't even want that anymore. I feel great. Except for when you eat it sometimes, you leave and you're like, why did I freaking eat that? I feel like crap. And so even I, like as a former fat dude, you know, it's like I went through that and still this day sometimes have to go through those same mental battles where it's like, man, all I want to do is do this, or again, earning it where yeah. I've wanted ice cream. When I get sick, I want ice cream. Ever since Sunday, I want ice cream every single day. I haven't had ice cream once. I'm like, Thursday. I'm going to have something that's super high quality that I love Thursday. And it's like, I've been able to make it from Sunday to Thursday as the former fat dude, just off of like, all right, like I'm not having it today. I'm going to have the discipline to have it in a certain time frame. Are you one of those dudes that like cuts everything out, or can people have some quality, awesome food at some point?
Completely. There's so much enjoyment in food. I don't think you should rob yourself of that. The key is exactly what you said. It's getting the nutritious stuff in first and making sure that most of what you eat is that nutritious stuff. If 80% of the meals you're eating are good, high quality, whole foods, that 20% isn't going to hurt you that much. And it turns into changing your mindset a little bit, not of going like, this is a good food, this is a bad food, but there are foods that nourish your body and there are foods that, like, let's be honest, are toys, right? They're just fun. They feel good. They taste great. And I am never going to tell somebody, hey, you should never eat a piece of your kid's birthday cake. That's a tragedy, man. That's an important moment in your life you want to be able to share. And I happen to love ice cream. That's like my favorite thing too. And I don't ever want to live in a way that I can never have ice cream, but I don't eat ice cream every day. Almost everything that I eat is really, really healthy. And the cool thing is that not only do I get the results then, you know, I get to look and feel the way I want to look and feel, but in those moments where I do decide, hey, I've been doing great, I'm going to have some ice cream, I get to actually just enjoy that ice cream instead of like feeling like crap about myself after I eat it. You know, you really get to enjoy and still know that you're doing the right thing and feeling good if you get it right most of the time.
I used to have a quote back in the day that says, and people hated it, I used to always say that you never regret the meals that you do have. You only regret the meals that you don't have. And people used to be like, what? And I'm like, dude, for 4 years, I weighed all my food. And I said, no, I went to these epic places with handmade desserts. And every time, nope, not touching it. I never touched it. And it's like, for what? That little extra bit of leanness and all these different things I told myself, when really eating bad for 1 month, you can look terrible. Like if you ate every meal bad for a whole month, I mean, look at Fit's Fat to Fit. Like the dude started looking pretty terrible. Or, you know, for him, it still like he had like a great frame and all this stuff. But in general, compared to how he was, look how fast he was able to lose it. But it was like, and then all of a sudden I looked back and I was like, man, I never got to try that Australian lady's handmade blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, what would that have meant to me today? I wouldn't be still holding on to that piece of fat. But growing up, dude, I literally thought that the fat on the steak, I thought it just got like evenly smeared across your whole body. I was like, if you eat that on the steak, I'm like, it must go right in as fat. And so I was like, oh my gosh, I can't do this stuff. So people were eating Special K bars, et cetera. But dude, I appreciate this. This has been awesome. It's been fun going from a topic that we didn't even think we're going to go down all the way down to some fun stuff on the beginning stages of health and nutrition, which I think is awesome. We'll have to do something else again to go a little bit more deeper on these topics. But dude, I appreciate it. Is there anything that people can do to get more connected to the things that you talk about, you love to do, so that they can go a little bit deeper?
Yeah, you know, we talk about a lot of this fun stuff, whether it be family stuff, business stuff, health stuff. I share some of the things we're eating, some tips and tricks on that if you want to see how to incorporate healthier foods in your diet. And really the best place to connect with me on that is just on social networks, on Instagram and Facebook. Wallace Vigo Nelson is my handle there, just my full name. But would love to see you guys there. Go ahead and DM me. I'd love to help any way I can.
Awesome, man. Thanks so much again.
My pleasure, Nicholas. Thank you, man.